My first speaker now is Brandon Geek, W-A-9-R-E-V, and he's going to be speaking about an ARIS contact, and he would like to have the title, Cell Phones Down, Radios Up. Brandon?
Good morning. My name is Brandon Geek, and I'd like to present to you today my presentation called Cell Phones Down, Radios Up. So, yes, my name is Brandon Geek. Yes, the last name is pronounced Geek, so I guess you could call me a ham radio geek. I passed my technician exam on April 9th, 2015, after two attempts. I was then licensed and excruciating 2 weeks later as KD9DQV. On May 19th, 2015, I decided I wanted my own custom vanity call sign, so I switched to WA9REV, my current call sign. Anyways, on June 23rd, I passed my general exam. Funny enough, I only had to wait 3 days for that upgrade to come in. Kind of confused me a little bit. Some other facts about me outside of ham radio is that I play football. I speak a little bit of French. Allez la vidéo. I also play guitar. I'm also a sophomore at McConaughey High School, which is kind of shocking to some people. The radios I use are an ICOM 7600 for HF, a Kenwood TM-281 for VHF, and a Ushun handheld for VHF and UHF. I also recently, last November, got my first DMR radio, courtesy of my father, and I love using it. So these are a few pictures of my radios. The top one is a panoramic picture I took with my iPhone. From left to right, it shows the entire ham shack. And then on the bottom left is the IC7600, and on the right is all my other various radios that I spoke about. So the main thing I really want to get my attention on today is our ARIS contact that we did at my school. Back in August 2015, we contacted the International Space Station via amateur radio with the major help of ARIS, which stands for Amateur Radio on the International Space Station. We contacted, and excuse my pronunciation skills here, Mr. Kimiuya Yui, a Japanese astronaut. He has a ham with a call of KG5BPH. Now, the contact itself only lasted for about 12 minutes, but months of preparation went into that tiny 12-minute conversation. I now have a small clip I'd like to show you of our presentation.
Let's think about these crew members and also ground. Thank you. Over.
Have you ever had a meteor hit the space station? Over.
Thank you for the question. Not only the meteor, but like a small space debris actually hit the station, but we have sealed, so no problem. Over. Thank you.
Do you ever get bored in space? Over.
Thank you for the question. We have really nice view the Earth, so I'm never bored. Get bored. Thank you.
Why does being an astronaut require such a high education? Over.
Thank you for the question. Because we have a lot of training. In order to become an astronaut or in order to fly, but in order to understand what we are going to learn, we need more like a math or scientific knowledge. So that's why. Thank you. Over.
If part of the ISS gets destroyed, are there emergency doors to keep everything getting sucked out? Over.
Good question. Actually, each module has hatches, so in case of emergency, we can close the door. So that's how ISS works. Thank you. Over.
What? Okay, so some more details about the contact. Like I said, it was 12 minutes long, and only a select group of faculty members and students were chosen to ask questions. Two radios were used, one as a primary, one as a backup. They were both ICOM IC7000s. And like I said earlier, there were months of preparing for this contact. So what was our outcome from the contact? Well, there was tremendous support from all schools. We had a high level of enthusiasm in not only our contact with the International Space Station, but amateur radio as well. Over 1,200 students watched it live, two network and three newspaper journalists showed up. Now, with all the enthusiasm and support, how do you keep such a tremendous hobby and how do you keep such a tremendous crowd interested in such a powerful hobby? Well, here are some tips. Well, you tell them about the similarity there is when it comes to operating a walkie-talkie. And the amateur radio isn't an expensive hobby. It only becomes it if you let it be. You can even do ham radio on your smartphone. The courtesy of the app Echolink is the one I like to use a lot. Every day you always have the possibility of meeting someone that'll get to know you. And here's the best part of all. You get to make friends with people who live all the way over the pond. Who thought talking to someone in France, Israel, or Spain would be this easy? And beyond that, there are endless possibilities. So how can we be implemented into the teenage community? Well, like I said earlier, you have cell phones and other electronic devices. So like I said, Echolink, one of my favorite apps allows you to use the capability of ham radio in your smartphone. There are also many study materials within both Android and Apple stores. And also, this is one of my more popular things I like to talk about, is school clubs. Nationwide, there are several schools around America who have a ham radio club. Some have multiple repeaters. And I say repeaters, plural, because some schools have multiple repeaters, which I find very, very fantastic. Another thing that's very popular among teenagers is the school club roundup by the ARRL. Roundup is an amateur radio contest period that occurs in the fall and spring on a certain weekend picked by ARRL. Roundup always allows teens who are hams and who aren't get to experience ham radio. Last fall, I had the opportunity to experience it for the first time. All who participated at my school were greatly intrigued and wanted to get their license. We made contacts with people all over the country, including Texas, New York, and Tennessee. I encourage those schools who have not yet heard of Roundup and who are teenagers and who know people who are licensed to try ARRL Roundup. So I then went up to a few of my friends who aren't licensed, but I asked them two simple questions. I said, tell me the first thing that comes to mind when it comes to what you think of a radio. And have you ever heard of amateur ham radio? And the responses were, Charlene, my first friend told me dials, trying to find a frequency in gamma rays. I didn't quite understand the gamma ray part, but she did say if it comes to ham radio, she would love it because it involves talking, and she is a talker. Megan, my other friend, told me communications, radio waves, and gamma rays. But when it comes to amateur radio, she seemed like it sounded familiar because she thought it had helped people. And I thought, man, you're pretty smart. You must got this down. I went on then to explain to both girls all the different possibilities of amateur radio. And then I keyed up the radio, and I put my call center on a local repeater. And Danny Webb, N9MOS, really, he came back, and he gave a really good explanation to both girls on everything you can do with ham radio. So as Megan listened along to Danny, she seemed more and more intrigued. I couldn't get her to talk on the radio as much as I tried, but she did seem very interested. She is currently studying for her technician exam. So in closing today, I just want to let everyone know that ham radio plays a very important role in everything, especially STEM schools, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. These schools who implement this function of communication into their education system will definitely see results from students' academic, social skills, and character. I want to thank everyone who attended Dayton this year and the Youth Forum. Thank you to Carol Perry for letting me speak today. My father, Kevin Geek, W9KEG, Bill McAlpin, WD9GIU, Danny Webb, N9MOS, Charlie Lossing, and Megan O'Terry. I hope everyone has a great time at the Dayton Hamvention this year. Thank you.
It's hard to even know how you follow a confident, articulate young person up at a microphone in front of a room filled with adults. I never get tired of this. I think that's fabulous. Also, please note when they come up, part of the 10 months of my nagging, I meant coaching of them, is... Please notice that they are all appropriately attired for a public speaking venue. And the confidence and the speaking opportunity that goes along with all of this. Okay, now I have two special young men who are going to come up. Eli Musgrave, KM4HFZ, who is 15 years old. Zach Hidari, KM4QIV, who is 14 years old. They are from the Mill Springs Academy. And before I turn the microphone over to them, I would like to acknowledge their teacher, who I became good friends with after speaking in Georgia last year. Martha Muir, please raise your hand. One of the important links we have here for support. So besides Elmer's playing a key role, Elmira's do as well. Thank you, Martha. Gentlemen, thank you.
Good morning. My name is Zach Haydary, KM4QIV, and this is Eli Musgrave, KM4HFZ, and we're here to invite you to discover the fun and magic of digital radio communications. Questions and statements we often hear from non-hams. Ham radio is old, more than 100 years old. Do people still use ham radio? We now have computers, we now have cell phones, and we now have the internet. So why do we still need ham radio?
Responses by hams. What if the internet and cell phones are not working? Ham radio to the rescue to provide emergency communications. We can demonstrate the transition from 100 plus year old technology to the latest computerized digital technology.
The North Fulton Amateur Radio League, NFARL, presented ham radio at the North Springs Charter High School STEM event in Atlanta, Georgia. Included was a digital station where Eli showed visiting high school students how they could send text messages without using their cell phones or the internet. Until they actually tried it, their typical response was, "That's impossible."
The North Fulton Amateur Radio League, NFARL, presented ham radio at the Atlanta Science Festival Exploration Expo last March. Included was a digital station where Trey, KK4QJB, showed visitors how they could send text messages without using cell phones or the internet. Again, until they actually tried it, their typical response was no way.
Voice versus digital. A great use of voice to exchange information. What's your favorite flavor of ice cream?
Chocolate. Anybody else here? Chocolate, anybody?
Not so great use of voice to exchange information. Please be advised that we are transferring 15 patients to your emergency room presenting possible symptoms of pneumonitrimicroscopic silicovolcaniosis.
It's a real word. Don't ask. It's a real word.
As a result of volcanic eruption near Mill Springs Academy.
Digital is far superior for sending in info that is hard to say, needs to be kept as a permanent record, and it can get through under poor signal conditions where voice transmissions fail.
At Mill Springs Academy, we have been using a suite of software programs called FLDigi, Fast Light Digital Modem Application, written by W1HKJ, David H. Priest, Jr.
This software integrates conventional ham radios with digital technology to encode and decode tones that are transmitted and received. The integrated software programs convert those tones into text, forms, and data.
Here's a screenshot of FLDigi in BPSK31 mode.
And so in that region there, it's called the waterfall, where you are able to see the transmitting signals. Those are the yellow columns, and if you would like to see what they are saying, you can press on it, and what they are sending will come up as text in the yellow area in black. And so if you want to send something out, you can type it out in the blue area, and and you can hit the transmit and receive button over in the bottom right corner to transmit it, and so that will show up as the red text. And over in the top left in the green, that is the, like, say, frequency that we are operating on.
Mill Springs Academy students made nearly 100 BPS K31 digital contacts in the middle of the night during field day last June. For February 2015 school club roundup, most of our contacts were made using digital. We even taught the non-ham students at our school how to do it.
One of the digital modes used by W1AW for daily bulletins is MFS K16. Multi-frequency shift key, 16 baud, 58 words per minute, bandwidth of 316 hertz. It is more melodic than some of the other modes.
Of course, not all ham radio transmissions from Mill Springs Academy are digital. As you can see on the August 2015 cover picture from QST, chosen by the ARRL as the August QST Centennial Cover Photo Contest winner, this photo shows Megan, K4MCB, at her club station.
This slide shows you that FL Digi takes the acoustic signal from this handheld radio and sends it to the microphone of a computer. With the help of computer converts that sound signal to text words on the screen that the operator can read.
So, going in the other direction, you have some options. You could type your text message and let FL Digi send it to a radio where it will be received as a regular audible radio signal. Or you could type your text message and it will be sent using FL Digi to another computer where it will show up as a signal on the waterfall, which when a user clicks on it, it will display the signal as a text.
It sure has been and continues to be a lot of fun to implement the transition from 100-plus-year-old ham radio technology to the latest in computerized digital ham radio technology. What else could techie guys and gals ask for?
As we're wrapping up, we would like to take a moment to thank all our mentors and friends at the North Fulton Amateur Radio League for helping us incorporate amateur radio in both our lives and school and inviting us to join them in all their fun activities. Most notably, we would like to recognize Wes Lamboli, W3WL, John Clute, K4SQC, Martha Muir, W4MSA, Chuck Catledge, AE4CW, Mike Cohen, AD4MC, and our very special friend, Jim Stafford, W4QO. Thank you very much.
When they left, one of them said, "Glad that's over." I told you they'd all be great, and so far they all are. Okay, this next young man, Skylar Fennell, KD0WHB, 17 years old. I had the pleasure of meeting, 4 days ago when I was in Colorado, 3 days, whenever it was, I was in a different time zone, at HamCon Colorado. Skylar has already been chosen to be a presenter here, and he comes highly recommended by good friends of mine who I trust their judgment, and says Skylar can hold his own on a conversation with engineers. So he was already in. But then last weekend at the banquet in Colorado, Skylar got a surprise. I knew about it. They tipped me off and said not to tell you, but to include it in my presentation of you here. He has the distinction at the banquet there from the Rocky Mountain Division of being nominated as the 2015 Young Ham of the Year. That was an award he got at the banquet. But wait, there's more. Skylar was then called back to the podium because he also was given the 2015 Rocky Mountain Division ARRL Technical Achievement Award that night. Skylar?
Good evening, everyone. My name's Skylar. My call sign is KD0WHB, and I'm an amateur extra operator for about 2 years. I really got interested in amateur radio through electronics and building stuff. When I was really young, I always took apart everything, made my parents always so mad. They're like, stop messing with it. It works. And I always just had a passion for understanding how things worked. In ninth grade, my best friend in high school, he actually had a general class license, and he got me interested in amateur radio, showing me, look at this, you can bounce waves off the atmosphere, you can operate on all these different bands, and just, he really, his call sign was KD0MLV, Jordan, and he really got me into it. So this is a book that I really enjoy. It's Crystal Sets to Sideband by Frank Harris, K-0-I-Y-E. I actually came across this book. I was asking on different internet forums how radio waves work. I was just, before I had my license, I wanted to know how can I build radio transmitters and receivers, how can I learn more about wireless? How does it work? What is the magic behind it? And someone recommended this book, it's a free PDF online, by a local ham, actually, who's only 45 minutes from where we live. I didn't realize that until later, and I looked up his call. I'm like, hey, he's in Boulder. And I actually was able to meet him, and he has an amazing station. He's on sideband from 80 to 10 meters, sideband CW. I think he's working on FM now. It's entirely home built, entirely. I think the only thing, I guess there is that oscilloscope there and then that AM receiver you can see, but I think everything else is completely homebrew. So that was pretty amazing. And really enjoyed his work. One of my favorite projects that I've got to work on is setting up a repeater at a school. I set this up at the STEM school and academy in Highlands Ranch. I don't attend this school, but I'm a part of their radio club. Thanks to Paul is actually somewhere here, N0AH, he's and Anna, his daughter, they're both at the STEM school. And they wanted a repeater, and we had very little budget. We were like a couple hundred maybe most that we built this on, and we used parts found at random hams. They're like, oh, I have a duplexer, let's put this together. And then we used an old Motorola desk track. We modified it to get down to the ham band. And then we also got Echolink and All-Star Link on it using a Raspberry Pi and a USB radio interface. And so that was really fun to work with them on it. I got to work with the internet department for the Raspberry Pi. I got to work with, I don't remember, people to get the antenna up. And there was a lot of different things. A recent project I just put together was a 900 megahertz repeater. This is I actually built this for less than I could build a 440 repeater just because of parts I found around this duplexer you see here. It's a it came from an old cellular site. One of my ham buddies, he's like, "Oh, I have this laying around. Do you want to try that out?" And it works great. We didn't even have to tune it because it has a 3 megahertz band pass on each end. It like a 901 to 902, and up at 927 to 930. So it was already worked for the cellular service there, but an old cellular system. But I was able to get it to play without even tuning it because of the wide band pass. Here's some more photos of it. You can see the bottom left. I'm using a Raspberry Pi with a USB radio interface for a controller. It's a lot cheaper than having to get like a big SCOM and do all this. And then through this, you can program it to do whatever you want on the Raspberry Pi. You can, now it's linked to the internet too, so you can connect to other repeaters around the world. And basically, whatever your creativity is the limit for using a Raspberry Pi and a USB radio interface for a repeater controller. Now, here's the picture on the top right is when I had to change the filters for these TK. I got these TK941 radios for free. They're commercial 900 megahertz. On this picture, I just directly jumpered the filters, but I did eventually get around to finding new 915 megahertz filters and replaced those. These 900 radios, the only problem is they have a fixed 39 megahertz offset, so they're really not good for using for like operating repeaters that are 25 meg split. So, but if you turn talk around on, they're on simplex, and then you just use one for a receiver and one for a transmitter, and they're perfect for a repeater. I really love the All-Star Link system. It's open source, it's Linux-based, and it just, your creativity is really the limit. I know a lot of systems in Colorado, the Fun Machine south of me in Pueblo, they have microwave links with analog repeaters. They use microwave internet links to link the repeaters together, and then they use All-Star Link for the voice for the analog repeaters. The Colorado Connection is now transitioning to All-Star Link, and I think it really fits amateur radio when you have technology. It's based off the Asterisk phone system, and Asterisk is used for a lot of businesses, and app RPT was made by Jim Dixon based off of it, and it adds like repeater IDs, repeater offset, repeater tones, encoding and decoding in software. It can decode subaudible tones. There's a lot of stuff packed in the All-Star Linux OS. One of my first All-Star project was with the Rocky Mount Radio League to put a link up to their mountain. Now they had a very, they really didn't want to put anything else up on the mountain. They wanted to leave it how it was, so I had to do half duplex. I had to have it on the input, and as you see here, I have it, just my receiver on, the repeater transmitted on 449.875. My machine was on 444. So it's just like a normal radio would see it. But I set this up, different parts, those fans up there you can see, I got those in an old abandoned site in El Dorado Mountain for free, and a Motorola SM120 radio I got for free from some ham. That power supply, I paid for that, but I got that for like $100, that big 50-amp Astron power supply, and then an old laptop for the repeater for the node controller to actually get to the internet. So now with this link system hooked into El Dorado Mountain, now if you're anywhere in range of this mountain, you can access All-Star and talk around the world. And this mountain it has great coverage. It's right up against the foot. It's right on one of the early foothills, so it get, I don't know what the range, whatever, lot in the distance. Here's just a diagram of the setup I had for the original All-Star link to El Dorado Mountain. Now, for an interface to All-Star, you have to have a sound card. So you can either buy a USB radio interface for about $75, or you can get it off of eBay for like $3, you get a sound chip, or a CM108-based sound card, and all you have to do is solder directly to one of those pins on the chip, and then you have PTT, so then solder to another pin, and you get COR in from your repeaters. So I've built several of those. I have one of the USB radio interfaces, but if you want to have a fun little project, those sound cards are really good for repeater controllers for All-Star, and they're cheap, and you can screw up a few times, and yeah. So this is I built about 5 units of these. Going to continue over the summer. I actually built these to fundraise to get plane tickets to come to Dayton. These are basically a Baofeng BF-888 radio, one of those cheap UHF radios, as well as a sound card, all packaged in one box. You can program it with a little Baofeng programmer, and then you can go to any of the 16 channels on it. And what this acts as is a little All-Star portable hotspot. So now you can plug in your Raspberry Pi or your computer or whatever you want. And then as long as you're in range of this little nano node, you can access All-Star Link and talk to other repeaters around the world. So I actually have it with me. I don't have the power for the Raspberry Pi, but I can just show it later. But anyway, this nano node, I built a few units of them, and they're really successful. I have it set up at some people's houses, and they just get on their handy talkie, and they can talk to other repeaters around the world. So,
how much?
I sold them for $55, and I don't know if I lost money because it took a lot of time to construct. I was down there in the basement trying to tackle RFI for hours and hours on each individual unit because each one had a different RFI issue. So I lost money, but you know, it was a fun project. And I have plans for making a newer version, plans on starting to prototype my own circuit boards and build these units, but yeah. A recent project I've been working on is a remote base for VHF and UHF that I'm going to put up on Blue Mountain. I'm using I'll just go to the pictures. A Motorola Radius. These are great radios. They're really old, but they're cheap, and you can program it up with the old DOS software. But anyway. There's binary select is on the very back to switch channels, but you only get about 8 channels, and you can modify these up to 40. So what I did to be able to remotely get to any channel, so this remote base is going to be accessed, because there's internet up at the site, so you can access the remote base from anywhere and then talk on VHF or UHF. And I want to be able to access all 40 channels on the radio. So what I did was I actually made a script and built some interface to the radio. That's what this the top left is, the interface I built, and then I soldered directly. That's right on the bottom is right underneath the LCD display, or the LED, the 7 segment display, and the top right is the actual front of the radio. I built a script that'll actually read the display, so it'll know what channel it's on, and then it'll pulse the up and down arrows a certain amount of times to get to the desired channel. And it works great. It pulses really quick, so you get through all 32 channels in a couple seconds. And this is actually the method I used. If you notice, the number 2 is the only channel, only number that does not have the very right bottom segment lit. So it'll pulse really quickly, and then it'll know when it gets to 2. And you might be asking, what about channel 12 and 22 and 32? Well, I actually renamed those to like 99, 98, 97. So it'll know when it gets to channel 2, it'll know that, and then it knows how many times it has to pulse do I go up two arrows to get to 32? Do I go down to get to, or do I go down two times to get to channel 32? Do I get up? So that's the method I use for this remote base, and it works pretty well. For the Courage Classic bike race, I built my own sound card packet TNC, kind of like those All-Star repeater interfaces. This first one is actually, I just built a Vox circuit to trigger the PTT. In future versions, I figured out there's a Hamlib library for Linux to control PTT. But I built this. Okay, how much time do I have? 3 minutes? Okay. Here's all the software I used for it. I have Ubuntu, Direwolf for the sound GPS, for the sound packet, GPS for a USB GPS interface. So that, you can just look at that. That's all the Linux software I used for the packet radio. A mobile crossband repeater controller I built for the Courage Classic Bike Race 2. Here, that's okay. That was me doing communications. It kind of got messy. I talked about this already. The Motorola radios are really easy to find because of FCC narrowbanding. This is my homebrew amateur satellite antenna I built for operating amateur satellites. I built this out of some stuff from Home Depot and put that together. So I'm just trying to get through this quickly. The Edge of Space Sciences missions, I've done a few of these. This experiment right here was a electrostatic field mill, so it detected high altitude or voltages. We also had APRS on this balloon, and that was that was our messy setup for tracking the balloon in the passenger seat of the car. Yeah, launch right there. And here are some of my future amateur radio goals that I want to complete. I really want to learn more about discrete circuitry and RF design, and want to get more into microwaves and higher frequency, and experiment with VLF too. I'd really like to thank Carol Perry for having me speak here. It's been a pleasure coming to Dayton. I'd like to thank Paul in 0AH for kind of getting me to come here, and I'd also like to thank, what's they're called, the people I'm staying with, KD8, NUA, and NUC for letting me stay with them for this trip. And yeah, thanks so much.
Thank you, Skyler, that was great. I think we should all get a half of college credit for for sitting through that. That was great, Skyler. Thank you. Remember, these kids are limited in time because of the amount of speakers we have, but you can see them at the youth booth this afternoon. We're going to ask them to be there so you can ask them more questions and speak with them. That's booth 225 in the North Hall. And they will be there. Okay, our next speaker is another award winner, William Ferguson, KJ4EYZ, is the winner of the 2015 Youth Plaque for the Virginia CUSO Party, sponsored by K4AMG. And he'll be speaking about setting up a radio station to chase DX. At a young age, William caught the DX bug. He was first licensed in 2008 at the age of 7. William is one of the youngest in the world to receive his DXCC at age of 8. Wow. since then, he has increased his capabilities of acquiring a DX station by using advanced DX chasing techniques, of course. William?
All right, so good morning. And as you know, my name is William Ferguson, and my call sign is KJ4EYZ. I have been DXing since the age of 7, and I'd also like to thank you for giving me this opportunity to present to you. So DXing is kind of like fishing. When you go fishing, you cast your line, and you slowly retrieve your lure, hoping to get a nibble or a bite. Sometimes you cast, and you get nothing. Sometimes the person next to you is catching fish, cast after cast. What do? You evaluate your tackle and improve on technique. So let's get to some background. The ham radio operator station in the 1950s consisted of a crystal-controlled transmitter and a receiver, along with a simple antenna. The SOP, or standard operating procedure, for chasing or working DX was as followed. First, make sure your crystal frequency was not occupied, and then to start calling CQ. With your receiver, you would tune around your transmitting frequency and listen if any station was answering your call. The operators who achieved the DXC back then truly did it the hard way. So let's fast forward to today. The most simple ham radio setup consists of a HF radio, a length of coax, and a broadband antenna. The basic setup. The basic setup can provide years of enjoyment and a pile of QSL cards. The key factor of catching the rare DX is to listen. The operator should be courteous and have great sportsmanship, but for those who enjoy the technical aspect of their station, like myself, the following brief will describe certain methods to improve your success through station optimization and knowledge. But in order to improve on something, one must baseline or quantify their existing station. Baselining your current system. In order to baseline your system, you will need to work with all the same units. Since loss and gains of system components are usually given in dB, we will be using dBW, or decibel watts. This will allow us to add and subtract system gains and losses much easier. So work with the decibel unit. A dB is a unit of measurement which has to be referenced to something for meaning. dBW, or decibel watt, is a unit of power in decibel scale, referenced to 1 watt. So the first formula here in the red, they're both in red, but the first formula here, this is how you convert watts into dBW. The second function here is the reciprocal function of how you convert dBW into watts. Quantifying your basic setup. We all started with a basic radio system. Let's quantify a baseline system using an ICOM 756 Pro, 200 feet of RG8X coax, and an OCF Windom antenna. The typical radio output is approximately 100 watts, which is equivalent to 20 decibel watts. The radio's receiver specifications are the most important. The most important specification is the receiver's dynamic range. This is how well the receiver works when a nearby transmitter is close to your RX frequency or receiving frequency. The greater the dynamic range, the better the receiver will work a split operation DX station. Coaxial cable. In coaxial cable, the higher operating frequency, the greater the loss. Table 1 lists loss for traditional ham radio cables. So here in the orange/yellow, here is the table. Popular coaxial cables are the RG8X and the RG213. Note, these losses are only valid to 1-to-1 VSWR voltage standing wave ratios. If the VSWR of the antenna is not 1-to-1, loss will increase. To calculate the loss with your VSWR, there are numerous websites to do dB loss calculators on them. The OCF Windom antenna. Pros. Multiband antenna. Fast install. Cons. Requires use of antenna tuner. An antenna radiation pattern is dependent on installation. For analysis purposes, let's assume it has a gain of a half a wave dipole antenna, 0 dB, 2.12 dBi plus 5 dBi ground gain. The max directive gain, 5 dBd, 7.12 dBi, and its front-to-back ratio is close to approximately 0 dB. The plot on the left is a typical VSWR plot of an off-center fed dipole antenna, or OCF. Front-to-back ratio is the ratio of front-to-back gain. For me, it is the most important aspect of the antenna. This is because the antenna reduces the noise from other directions and allows me to hear the DX station better. All right, our baseline performance system at 10 meters. So for the transceiver, the ICOM 756 Pro, its output power is 20 dBW, and its receiving dynamic range at 2 kHz is 71 dB. For the coax, RG8X coax at 200 feet, its loss at 28 MHz is 3.148 dB. And for the Windom OCF antenna, it's gained at 7.12 dBi, including the ground gain, and has a front-to-back ratio of approximately 0 dB. Its effective isotropic radiated power, or ERP, with all the losses and gains in the equation, will turn out to be 23.94 dBW. And if you use the aforementioned formula, you can turn that into 247.7 watts. This is assuming that there is no antenna tuner loss, VSWR additional cable loss, and antenna gain assumption. So how do we improve system performance? We choose a radio with better dynamic range. Here are some examples of radios which are in the top of their class for dynamic range. The Flex 7600 at 108 dB, followed by the Elecraft K3S at 106 dB, the ICOM 7850 LE at 105 dB, and the Yaesu FT5000 at 101 dB. The transceiver's receiver section should have a minimum of 80 dB for CW and 70 dB for SSB. As you can see in the pictures, in sequential order as I listed them, here are the pictures. Replace inefficient coax cable. Beware of some of the RG8X coax, since it only has a 60% shield. This could cause unwanted RFI, or radio frequency interference. Replace long coax runs with hardline. Surplus hardline can sometimes be found cheaper than traditional coax. Some hardline can be assembled with ordinary hand tools, such as a hacksaw, file, and wrenches. As you see to the left, the left photo, here are four different styles of coaxial cable. Notice the difference between the braids and the airspace, as this has much more... this has much more air gap compared to these coaxial cables, and how this is hardline. Antenna improvements for high bands. For the high bands, 10 to 20 meters, 30 to 40 meters, use directional antennas. To the left is the OptiBeam 18.6, that's all, and to the right, that is my stepper DB36. If possible, use directional antennas. Choose the antenna that has the greatest front-to-back ratio rather than just forward gain. The front-to-back on the OptiBeam approaches 25 dB. The stepper DB36 has a front-to-back ratio, which varies from 11 to 27 dB, which is band-dependent. For low-band transmit antennas, use a vertical antenna. The radiation pattern is great for low takeoff angles and is great for DX. The picture on the left is a picture of my 80 through 160 monopole antenna. The picture on the right is a typical radiation pattern of a monopole antenna. Note, antenna gain is greatest at the lower takeoff levels. As you notice right here in this purple/blue dot, this is the optimal takeoff. Low band receive antennas. Use a separate receive antenna for the low bands. Beveridge antennas, K9A loop antennas, 4-square antenna arrays, 8-square circle arrays are just examples. The receive antenna will provide some front-to-back ratio, allowing you to hear certain signals from certain directions while reducing the noise in other directions. The picture on the top is a picture of one of my 1,000-foot beverages for northeast and southwest reception. The picture on the bottom is my 4-square for 80 through 160 meters. RF power amplifiers. For chasing DX, I prefer a solid-state no-tune amplifier. This amp tracks the radio's frequency automatically, and it also reduces the number of stations tuning up on the DX. Additionally, it is instant on, which means no warm-up. And here is two pictures of me building and testing a legal limit HF to 6 meters amplifier. Going from 100 watts to 1500 watts will add 11.76 dB gain to system transmit performance. Since the S unit is 6 dB, we will be adding two S units to your transmit signal. I built my current 160 meter through 6 meter legal limit amplifier using parts provided by W6PQL. My current system analysis. So for my transceiver, the ICOM 7850LE, its dynamic range at 2 kilohertz is 105 dB. For my amplifier, including the transceiver, 1500 watts, which is 31.76 dBW. For the coaxial loss, 100 foot of LDF5, which is hardline, plus 100 foot of LMR600UH, which is ultraflex. If you add their losses together, it is negative 0.695 dB. For the antenna gain for the OptiBeam 18-6, its antenna gain is 15.6 dB, including the ground gain, and its front-to-back ratio is 25 dB. So its effective isotropic radiated power, with all the gains and losses added together, is 46.665 dBW, or 46.4 kW EIRP. So in summary, dynamic range improvement is 34 dB, its front-to-back improvement is 25 dB, and its transmitting power improvement is 22.6 dB. So now we have optimized the station's hardware. Where do we go next? Software and information. DX clusters. DX clusters show us where possible DX stations are operating. This can help us find that rare DX needed station. There are many DX clusters, and some of them have a software logging programs have a built-in function to view them. These clusters get its information from other hams along with skimming programs. A word of caution is that information on the cluster is not always correct. For example, split frequency not given, somebody logged the wrong call sign, or the DX station is working in only a specific zone or area. So it is advisable to listen with your own ears to confirm that it is the DX station. Research, upcoming DX expeditions. Keep current with upcoming events by reading QST, looking at DX World website, and N3GK. Run propagation forecasts. So, run propagation forecasts to determine the best time of day to operate or to communicate with the DX. The chart on the left was ran to determine what time of day and what band to use for my station to communicate with Macau. The right chart is a VOA cap online. To read a propagation, you'd look, well, it looks like it's cut off. So if I wanted to work Macau on 20 meters, look for the darker color, and it would be advisable to work Macau right before 1500 Zulu time. Same concept goes with the VOA cap map. Use a CW skimmer to find split DX. How many times have you heard the DX station is listening 5 to 30 kilohertz or more? How many CWs can fit in a 25 kilohertz of spectrum? If you assume that the average width of CW signal is 100 hertz, CW is a variable length code, then the answer would be 250 signals. I used a CW skimmer to find out the DX station's operating characteristics. Is the DX operator working the pile up by moving up or moving down? Is the station just listening to a particular frequency or just randomly moving around to find the loudest signal? The diagram shows a simplified setup of my station. The ICOM in split mode operation allows me to listen to the DX station and transmit frequency separately. The ICOM transmit frequency is tied together with both the CW skimmer and an SDR receiver. This setup allows me to look up to 192 kilohertz of CW signals. Looking at the CW skimmer display, I can determine the operating characteristics of the DX operator. This gives me a good starting point of where I should start transmitting. Here is a video I recorded last week of TN2 Mike Papa of Republic of Congo working split on 15 meters. Due to time constraints, I will have to fast forward a little bit. So as you see here, TN2 Mike Papa just worked EA1 DFP. Oh, hold on. I have to exit out of the presenting mode. There we go. Now he's working K3RA, as you can see now. As you see here now, he's moving down, so it would be advisable to start transmitting right under where he's moving down. So let me fast forward a bit. So here is my transmitter. And basically here's my SDR receiver, and to the right is my CW skimmer with its built-in decoder. So basically, what this is trying to show you is that if you're trying to change frequency on one, then the SDR receiver and the CW skimmer will also change. And just for one quick slide, and it would be done. So how do we improve our chances of working DX? The most important improvement you can do for your DX station is to. Your ears are your best tool for working DX. Listen. So the prioritized summary is that your ears are the best tool for working DX. Look at QST and other sites for upcoming DX expeditions. Use propagation software to calculate the best time to catch the DX expeditions. Use clusters to find DX. Choose antennas for 40 through 10 meters based on front-to-back ratio, not just gain. Vertical transmit antennas for low bands. Use separate receive antennas for low bands. Choose coax with lower loss. Replace the radio with better dynamic range. Use an amplifier to increase output power. Use the CW skimming software to find the split. And most importantly, have fun. I hope you have a great rest of the HamFest, and thank you.
Okay, again, you can meet all these youngsters in person at the RCA Youth Booth, the North Building 225. I just wanted you to get a sampling of each one because each one is just phenomenal in my opinion. Hope Lee, KM4IPF, is part of the fabulous Lee family. And hopefully you will be able to reach the mic. Oh, excellent. Okay, come on up, sweetheart. 9 years old, and we've been at a couple of conventions together, and she wows the audience for so many obvious reasons. And your younger sister just got her license, correct? So that's all four of them now, four youngsters, all licensed and all terrific, and certainly well able to do these presentations for me. So she's very much involved with satellite communications. And your topic is talking through the birds. Okay, a young lady, a young ham, and a young presenter here at Hamvention Youth Forum.
Hi, my name is Hope and my call sign is KM4IPF. When I was 8 years old, I got my technician in March 2015. When I was 9 years old, I upgraded to my general class in December 2015. That picture is of me after I got my general. What's really cool is now all of my family are hams, including my little sister Grace, KM4 Tango X-Ray Tango, who got her license on Monday. Since we homeschool, Mommy and Daddy decided to make ham radio a part of homeschooling. So after studying for 2 weeks, I took my test on a Friday. The next Wednesday, Richard Siff, W4BUE, led us, but mainly my brother and sister, to talk on a satellite. But there is a surprise in store. My license was in the database. Watch the video to see what happened.
YL from Kilo Mike 4.
Kilo Mike 4, India Papa Foxtrot. Fox Mike 1 6. My name is Hope. Hotel Oscar Papa Echo. Your signal report is 5 mile. You are my first QSO. I am 8 years old. I got my call sign today. Over.
Congratulations, congratulations to you.
So as you can see, my first QSO was talking through the birds. My adventures with ham radio satellites. Ham radio satellites orbit the Earth. One of their orbits is LEO, or low Earth orbit. There are two kinds of LEO orbiting satellites, linear satellites and FM satellites. Linear satellites, you can use single sideband or CW. Lots of QSOs can happen at a time. This is because the transponder has a wide bandwidth. My first QSO was on FO29. That is a linear bird. FM satellites act like a repeater in space, and only one QSO can happen at a time. This is because just like a repeater, only one, or the strongest signal is heard. The one signal that is strongest is heard, the other ones are not. Later I'm going to talk more about FM satellites. LEO satellites orbit about 400 miles up, and their orbits take about 90 to 100 minutes. The Earth rotates, well, you can see in the video, that video to help show, the satellite spins around the Earth the same place or the same path through space. However, the Earth rotates under the orbit of the satellite, so it can be at different angles on different passes. I usually talk on SO50 and AO85 because they are so easy that even a little kid can work them. During field day, we tried SO50. However, Daddy put in the wrong uplink, so we had... Don't worry, Daddy said I could say that. So you have to make sure everything is programmed in right. It doesn't cost a lot of money for the equipment either. Jerry Buxton, N0JY from AMSAT, used my picture for his NASA briefing about Fox 1A, AO85. He thought it was really cool that a little kid can work the satellites. Of course, you need your antenna. You can make your own or you can buy one. You need one or two VHF, UHF handheld radios. You need full duplex so that you can hear the radio while you transmit. Oh, not hear the radio, hear the downlink while you transmit. You need an app to predict the satellite passes and a compass. As you can see in the picture, I'm using my compass to find where the satellite will be. I use an Aero satellite antenna, two Yaesu FT60R radios, I use a Heil headset, my daddy's iPhone, and I have a compass, and I have different methods to hold my antenna. That's me at the beach with the radio strapped to the bathing suit and the antenna. Some of the methods I use to hold my antenna are my daddy's work tripod, PVC pipe holder, stick, holding with my own arm, and since I'm not quite strong enough, daddy's probably the best bet. In this picture, it shows me using the stick and the PVC pipe holder so that you know how it looks like. The app that I use is called ProSat. ProSat tells when the satellite will come over my location. It also tells the azimuth. Azimuth is where to point the antenna from left to right. It also tells elevation. Elevation is how high to point the antenna into the sky. The azimuth and the elevation put together show the path that the satellite will take through the sky. With the information you get from your prediction app, figure out the path that the satellite will take through the sky. It helps for this part to practice with landmarks. Like you might know that it will be from that tree to way up to at the middle of the sky to over down there, that for lease sign. Or maybe it will be anywhere between like that tree to way down at the bottom of the horizon to over to that other tree, or anywhere between that. You have to tune your radios to the correct frequency. You have to wait for the satellite to come over your location. I usually hear the satellite when it reaches about 2 degrees above the horizon. You have to follow the satellite across the sky with your antenna. And depending on the elevation of the pass can last from about 12 to 15 minutes. Doppler shift is having to change frequency. I have to change the Doppler shift when I can't hear the downlink clearly. It's kind of like a train. As it goes by, it makes an "ear" sound. Some don't understand it like that, but I do. The satellite spins in space, so you have to twist the antenna for polarity. You have to wait your turn. I'm talking about FM because that's what I usually do. But because it's FM, you can only have one station talk at a time. You have to exchange your call sign and give your Maidenhead grid score. There's so much going on, I usually feel like an octopus, or more that I need to be. This is a video showing how easy it is to work a satellite pass.
Kilo Mike 4, India Papa Foxtrot, EL 99.
AM 4, IPF, Kilo 8, Oscar Echo, K8OE, Echo Mary 70.
QSL Echo Mary 70. I am located in the EL 99. QSL?
QSL, thanks so much. Have a good day.
Kilo Mike 4, India Papa Foxtrot.
So as you can see, it's pretty easy to work a satellite. What's really cool about talking on the satellites is that I get to talk to and meet a lot of people. I talked to UT1FG stroke Maritime Mobile. That means he's on a boat. His name is Yuri. We got to visit his ship, and only one other ham had ever visited his ship before. That picture is of me and my siblings going onto his ship. I've worked a lot of DX, like St. Lucia, Haiti, Mexico, Canada, Cayman Islands, and Texas. I hear they want to be the newest DXCC entity. I also got a QSL card. I don't know where it is, but it's supposed to be here. Oh. But it's from Curacao. I've talked to Curacao and also the Falkland Islands. There are only like 4 people that are ham radio operators there. I've done a lot of grid activations, like the Chesapeake Bay Bridge Tunnel, the Outer Banks of North Carolina, and the Wright Brothers Monument. W1HQ, KX9X. W1HQ is a really cool call that the ARRL uses. And what was really cool is he got my grid that day because he called me with that cool call, and I was in a really rare grid, FM 21, I think it was. One time I got up at, forget this part. What was even cooler about the Wright Brothers Monument is that it was actually National Parks on the Air Day. One time I got up at 3 a.m. to work UT1FG / Maritime Mobile for the second time, and I was the only one on the satellite. That picture is of me at the Wright Brothers Monument. I've heard an astronaut, but never talked to one, but I plan to sometime. I've copied slow-scan television from the International Space Station. That picture on there is the same thing that we actually copied from it. I've worked W1AW, another cool call that the ARRL uses. Lots of AMSAT people know me. That's what my call sign is. KM4, I'm pretty famous. Someday I'd like to work more linear birds and build my own satellite antennas, work more rare DX, and sometime even be the DX. Sometime I want to go on the Youth DX adventure somewhere. I'm going to participate in the K1D Field Day. It's going to be an all-kid operated setup and taken down by kids. That's what it is, K1D, for kids. Be the voice of a future Fox satellite. Sometime I want to be the voice of a future Fox satellite that maybe it'll go up in a few years, maybe I'll never do it, but I want to sometime. One time I got up at 3 a.m. to work a satellite during Field Day last year, 2015, to work a satellite to get 100 bonus points for working it. However, that was the one Daddy put in the wrong uplink. Not trying that. But since I didn't get breakfast, you see me eating a Twinkie. Yum. Come watch a satellite pass. Later, I will be working SO50 at 12:16 today. The station will be located outside the main entrance to Ball Arena. If you want to see more satellite videos or videos about ham radio, you can go to HamRadio.World. HamRadio.World. Me and my family have made that to get new hams, kids, or even if you just want to know how to build an antenna or something. That's it for now. 73. I hope to talk to you through the birds.
She even picks up after herself over here. That's great. The whole Lee family is certainly a model for the rest of us. Kelsey Seymour, K3LSY, age 17. Kelsey is going to be doing a talk on preparing yourself, an in-depth look at Go Kits. Kelsey? And he's been our IT person up here at the computer this morning. Kelsey?
Thank you.
Okay, so my name is Kelsey Seymour, K3LSY, and I'm going to talk to you about amateur radio Go Kits and some lessons I've learned in creating some. So who am I? I've been involved with scouting for over 10 years. I've been licensed since 2012. I enjoy doing amateur radio contests and the occasional Soto Peak. That is me over there on Badua Land Mountain a couple weeks ago. And I will be on the 2017 K2BSA radio staff at the National Scout Jamboree. I got here, I started working with my Eagle project, and I wanted one that involved amateur radio. And some grant funding came in for creating Go Kits to improve amateur radio communication for the 7 North Central counties in Pennsylvania. When it was all said and done, I created 8 Go Kits and held 2 training sessions on how to use them, and as well as digital mode radio for the kits. So what is a Go Kit? A Go Kit is equipment and personal items needed to provide emergency communications. It is relatively small and easy to transport, and it should be self-supporting for at least 24 hours. With that definition, who here would have an amateur radio Go Kit? By a show of hands. So a good bit of the crowd. So who can use an amateur radio Go Kit? Your local emergency services, your state emergency services, your local amateur radio club, or how about you? What would you include in one? VHF and UHF radios is a good place to start for local communications. Your HF antenna and HF rig, batteries and chargers, laptops and software for digital modes, and accessories such as adapters, extra cables, and sound card interfaces for digital modes. What would you need as a person for yourself? Make sure you have a form of ID, a flashlight, some spare money, toiletries, food, water, emergency contact numbers, and anything else you would need to support yourself for 24 hours. So there's a couple ways you can lay out an amateur radio Go Kit. The common form is to put them in a Pelican case. You can have it grab and go, where you pull your foam out and just have your handhelds laid in there. That is a popular form to have a handful of handhelds in there. You open it up and you can start handing them out for use. I've also seen rack mount versions where they're small little rack mount containers, and they're self-contained, small, plug and play. Batteries are typically built in. All you need to do is add your antenna. Also, I have seen table set where you can mount your mobile and desk rigs on a piece of plywood with a couple handles on it, and you have desk space ready to go, and that is the option we chose for the ones I did. So what to do if you have one? Training is always a great place to start. FEMA has their ICS courses, as well as ARRL offers training, as well as Saturn, and maybe your local emergency management agency as well. You also want to practice using these kits. If they sit in a corner for the entire year and get pulled out only when you need them, you might not know how to use it or have to struggle to get it up and working. So if you use it for field day, your state CUSO party, nets, and public service events, you get the opportunity to pull them out, use them, and make sure you're still familiar and everything works as it should. I will go through an example of the one, which is what I did for my Eagle Scout project. It was held in a Pelican case. The lid of it, we had the lid organizer for accessories. The first layer, we had a FT897 for HF. The second layer was a Kenwood TMD710. And the third layer, we had the miscellaneous items that really didn't fit in elsewhere. So the lid here, we had a surge protector here in the little folder. We had the manuals and band plans for operating in that little pouch, an antenna switch, a dual band antenna with mag mount, and extra cables and chargers. Our first layer, we had a FT897 with the batteries installed, the tuner mounted, a power supply, a push-to-talk hand mic, a signal link interface, and a Heil push-to-talk headset. All this was pre-mounted, and all you had to do was plug in an antenna, turn on the radio, and you were set to go. All the cables were connected, so you didn't have to remember what went where, and it was plug and play. Our second layer, we had a Kenwood TMD710 with the GPS, a push-to-talk hand mic and power supply, an AVMAP G5 for APRS operations, a signal link for digital modes, and a headset with push-to-talk. Our third layer, we had miscellaneous items, including a 100-foot roll of coax, an antenna which varied between a coil vertical and a folded dipole, as well as external speakers for both radios. If anyone has any questions, I'll be over at the youth booth, and we'll be happy to answer any of your questions. 73s, and I would like to thank a couple people, the first being my father, AB3SE, for getting me here and supporting me. Jim Wilson, K5ND, for putting my name in the hat. Carol Perry for putting up with me and getting here. As well as Dennis Colgrove and November Delta 3 Oscar sitting there in the back for actually putting up with me for a much longer term of time and helping me with the project. Thank you.
Thank you. The caliber of the kids that are being presented to you today, I think, speaks for itself. You have to leave here with a smile and just be so proud to be part of the support for all these young hams. Jacob Nagel, AD0JA, is 16 years old, who will speak about CHIRP. It's not just for the birds. Using computer software to program your radio.
So, is anyone wondering why a photo of a chicken is displayed? Well, this is a picture of my sister's rooster, Chirp. Although he might be a bit annoyed that amateur radio operators are called hams and not chickens, Chirp is here to help introduce the topic of my presentation, another kind of chirp, which is free, open source amateur radio programming software. My name is Jacob Nagel, AD0JA, and besides raising a few heritage breeds of chickens like Chirp, I enjoy working on radio projects and talking on local repeaters. I discovered a common occurrence when talking to new amateur radio operators. Frequently, a new ham might obtain his license, purchase a radio, even make a few contacts, but ends up being intimidated by programming his radio. Sometimes, even longtime hams don't know how to utilize the new radio programming software. So, to solve this dilemma and minimize frustration, I will discuss the available options to program your radio, items needed for programming, and how to program your radio using Chirp software. To start with, four options are available to program your radio. First, the previously standard method of manually programming your radio using a printed repeater book and the VFO mode on your radio is inefficient and time-consuming, especially when trying to look up and enter multiple repeaters. Additionally, the book version is only updated yearly before printing, whereas the online repeater directories have the ability for real-time updates. A second option to program your radio involves programming software directly from the manufacturer, which may or may not be available for your brand of radio. For example, Kenwood provides free, downloadable programming software, but it is cumbersome to use. Data entry is time-consuming since it also requires either manual or copy and paste entry of each repeater's details. As a third option, RT Systems produces its own programming software and cables for most ham radios. It is easy to use, but it is proprietary software and potentially expensive. For example, a programming cable and software bundle for a Kenwood TM-V71A costs $55. But even if you have a cable that will work with different radios, each additional radio model requires another $25 in programming software. Finally, the fourth option for programming your radio is Chirp, and an online repeater database like repeaterbook.com. Chirp is downloadable programming software which is open source, not proprietary, and free. Besides being free of charge, another bonus is that it can program a vast array of amateur radios, including Kenwood, ICOM, and Yaesu models, as well as older Kenwood commercial radios. Additionally, data entry, especially for multiple repeaters, is quick and easy by simply copying and pasting information from repeater book. Since it is open source, free, and easy to use, I recommend everyone use Chirp. Similarly, the online repeater database I recommend is Repeater Book. Repeater Book is a free service provided by amateur radio operators who volunteer as state administrators. Recently, Repeater Book became available for repeaters worldwide. And I personally make daily updates to the Missouri, Illinois, and Indiana repeaters so the information is as up to date as possible. Furthermore, Radio Reference and RF Finder are both paid subscription services, and the other database option on Chirp only contains European repeaters. Now that I'm finished with my shameless advertising for Chirp and Repeater Book, a few items are required to use the Chirp programming software. First, regarding the computer operating system, Chirp requires Windows XP or a newer operating system. I will be covering Windows only, but Chirp is available for Mac OS X, as well as major distributions of Linux, including Ubuntu and Raspbian for the Raspberry Pi. Next, a radio programming cable with a serial connector is needed. I specifically recommend a cable with a serial connector. The cheaper cables that come with the USB connector have counterfeit prolific chips that are difficult, if not impossible, to use. I have heard that the $20 to $25 cables with FTDI chips work fine. However, it is cheaper to buy the cables with serial connectors, especially if you'll be programming several different models of radios. Also, determine the specific cable needed for your radio by either checking the owner's manual or looking at the ham mic connector, which is typically used for programming the radio. Most of the popular low-cost handhelds use a cable with a two-prong connector as shown and can be purchased for around $10. Instead of a ham mic connection, some radios are programmed through a specific data connector. However, such cables with a data connector are also around $10. Additionally, a serial port is required. So, if your computer does not have a serial port, a USB to serial converter is needed. I recommend the TrendNet TU-S9 USB to serial converter because it causes no RFI, uses a genuine prolific chip, is plug and play, and only costs about $10. The final item required is the actual Chirp software. The Chirp programming software can be downloaded from the chirp.danplanet.com web link shown on the screen. Click on the Windows Daily Builds link and click on the Windows Installer, which will be highlighted in green to start the download. After downloading Chirp, as well as securing a serial port converter, if needed, and a programming cable, Chirp is ready for installation. First, locate the Chirp installer, labeled Chirp-daily-whatever-the-date-is-installer, which will most likely be found in the Downloads folder on Windows 7 and higher operating systems. Double-click on it to launch the installer and click the Install button. When the installer is finished, click the Close button. Now that Chirp is installed, it is time to set up the radio connection and program the radio. First, plug the programming cable into the radio. Second, connect the programming cable to a serial port on the computer. If no serial port exists, connect the programming cable to the computer using a USB to serial converter. Third, open the Start menu, type in Device Manager, and click on Device Manager. Fourth, Device Manager will appear. Find the group labeled Ports, Common LPT, and double-click on it. If your computer has a physical serial port, most likely it will be COM1 or COM2. If using a USB 2 serial converter, look for the prolific USB to serial COM port device, write down the COM port number, and close the device manager. Next, click on the Start menu, go to All Programs, and click on Chirp. Once Chirp launches, click on the Radio menu tab, and then select Download from Radio. Select the COM port you wrote down, the radio vendor, and the radio model from the drop-down menus. All right, is everyone with me on step 8? We are already halfway through the steps. The eighth step is to turn on your radio that is connected to the programming cable and click OK in the box. Follow any instructions that appear. Some radios have to be put in clone mode while others download right away. Then, once Chirp has downloaded the memory data from your radio, click the File menu tab, then click Save As, and save the image of the data in a convenient place on your computer. 10th, click on the Radio menu tab again, hover over the Query Data Source, and then select Repeater Book. Select the state and county and band if needed. For example, if you want the 220 repeaters around Dayton, Ohio, select Ohio as the state, select Montgomery County as the county, and select 1.25 meters as the band, then click OK. The data query from Repeater Book will appear in another tab. Select that tab, then hold the Control key on your keyboard and select which entries you wish to copy to your radio. Step 13, right-click on the selected entries and select Copy. Switch back to the previous tab listing your radio, select an empty space, right-click, and select Paste. Finally, select the Radio menu tab. If the Upload to Radio option is grayed out, Chirp is operating in live mode and the frequencies are already in your radio. If the Upload to Radio option is not grayed out, click on Upload to Radio, then click OK. And that's all there is to it. The frequencies are now uploaded to your radio, and you are now ready to have fun talking on the new repeaters. I have discussed the options for programming your radio, the items needed to program with Chirp, and how to program a radio using Chirp and Repeater Book. By following these simplified step-by-step instructions, you can quickly and easily program your radio using Chirp software. For more information on Chirp, visit the website chirp.danplanet.com. Remember, as our rooster Chirp would say, don't be chicken, try Chirp. It's not just for the birds. Are there any quick questions?
No.
Okay. Thank you.
Quick questions can be at the RCA booth, 225 at the youth booth. That's why we're sending all the kids there. What a voice. What a speaking voice. When I speak with him on the phone, I feel like I'm speaking with a broadcasting person. Okay, the next young man, Marty Sulloway, KC1CWF, is 13 years old. I met him at Boxborough in August, and after speaking with him for 4 minutes, I said, you're hired. You're coming to the Youth Forum. And at least 8 different radio organizations have contacted me to say, did you get Marty as a speaker? Here's Marty. You'll love this. Marty Sulloway, KC1CWF.
Okay, very good. Hello, everybody. I'm Marty, KC1CWF. And today we'll be talking about some homebrewing fun and building equipment for contest stations. So who am I? Hi, as I say, I'm Marty, KC1CWF. I'm 14, live in Newton, Massachusetts, and I'm a very active radio operator, mainly involved with radio sport, contesting, and other activities like that, and homebrewing. So what is homebrewing? Obviously, we're here to talk about that today. Why do we homebrew, more importantly? Well, we homebrew for another reasons, or the main reasons I homebrew are often for the cost. When I make something by myself, I can often do that for cheaper than it would cost if I were to buy a part or a piece of gear off the shelf. It can also be made to fit my needs. Sometimes what's available in the stores isn't actually what I need, and instead of piecing something together that would sort of do what I need, I can buy it myself. And it's fun. Working on something you're proud of, building it yourself, is really exciting. And it's a learning moment, too. You don't know it all, so it's a great way to practice your skills, building something that you can use in your station every day. You can improve your soldering or experiment with new technology, so it's all really fun. So if you saw the beginning, that first slide, it mentioned contesting. So where does that fit into all of this? Every station for contesting is different and must fit the needs of the operator or operators in the station. Often, the exact piece of gear needed for a large, complex, or advanced contest station isn't on the market or doesn't even exist. An example would be that many contest stations have are quite large and have many antennas and antenna systems, and they need to all be handled in a special way. And again, customization is needed to fit the needs of the operator. So my project and my example here for you today is antenna switching. An asset in contest station design and operation is automation, and removing as many of the unnecessary controls from the operator as possible. Automation of critical tasks is really helpful, especially after you've been in the chair for a long period, or maybe you haven't slept in 2 days. And I, at home personally, got very sick of manually switching my antennas every time I changed bands or needed to beam a different direction or something like that. And I was also afraid of selecting the wrong antennas then and again, maybe after 40, 45 hours in a chair, maybe sleeping for 2 hours, old, cranky, and it's easy to screw up critical things in a station that could really break something or have negative impact at that point. Many leading stations do have systems that will automate antenna switching and take those controls out of the operator's hands. As you can imagine, it's very critical that you don't select the wrong antenna, you don't break something, you don't blow up an amplifier or a radio in the middle of a contest. And there's many products on the market that do this and allow for automation of antennas, switching antennas or maybe bandpass filters in a contest station. But there wasn't anything that really was on my price range or did what I wanted to do, so I figured I'd build a system that did what I wanted to do. So my project, as I say, is antenna switching. For my project, I had a few goals. I wanted the full automation of my station for switching of antennas and bandpass filters, the ability to take manual control after something breaks or a part blows in the middle of a contest and I don't want to end or stop. I wanted it to keep working. So I wanted to make my system, all the automation, invisible in case I needed to make it invisible. So if I could turn the power off to all the units I designed, that manual control could be used, and the station, the system, wouldn't be there basically, and out of the way, and you could continue on in the operation. I wanted system to be available to handle more gear in the future besides antennas, like bandpass filters, and I wanted to keep as much switching and coaxes and other distractions away from the operating position, so I could have my area as clean and organized as possible to keep my hands on the keyboard and focus on being as efficient as possible. In the picture below, you see an off-the-shelf relay board that was used as part of my project to allow automation. And that actually is a built-in web server that can be controlled using some basic code to switch in and control antennas. So there's a little bit of hardware I used for this project. All of it was kind of cobbled off the shelf and wired together. Parts of it came from different places and kind of constructed to fit my needs. So I have a relay board, which is really a remote coax switch that can be in the yard, or I currently have it in my yard, that has all my HF antennas going into it. And that can be controlled using a normal control console, like is shown right. No, the slides didn't switch, did they? They switched back. I apologize, everybody. Sorry, there's a malfunction here. Like this box right here. And that can be used to switch antennas manually. That comes with the remote coax, which I used, which is from a Maritron subsidiary of MFJ. And then there's also that other relay board that was in the previous slide, as I pointed out. And that's controlled over the network, and that's kind of the core of my system, which switches all my antennas. So It's not all magic. There's software behind that I designed that controls all of this. And the software for my whole project was written in a language called Python. And I have some basic programming skills, and I'm slowly learning. And once I feel that my code isn't working, is working well, I may release it to the public so people could do stuff with it. So just a quick workflow of how we get from a radio to an antenna and how everything is switched. Here's a quick example. The radio is connected to a computer, which is running a contest logging software in a contest. I have support designed to work with a number of contesting software packages, but in my case, I've been using N1MM Plus. And the software sends out a frequency broadcast over the wireless network, and that contains obviously some key information about the frequency and the mode that the radio is in. And that then goes to my software, which can decode that and figure out which radio it's coming from, and if what antenna should be there, and what's the best antenna on the band that I can use if I have multiple antennas, maybe for a second radio and I want the best antenna on one radio. And then that software can send commands to that control board with the network server that I showed in a few pictures back, which will then send 12-volt power out to the actual remote coax switch, which is stationed in the yard. So just a quick diagram that shows all this is right here. We have the radio again, which talks to the computer, which then can talk to the relay board that I bought off the shelf that has that controller in it. And that goes immediately to the coax switch, or that manual controller can go straight through and come around without going through the computer or the relay board. This all can be bypassed. And again, the switching scheme out of this box, there's a number of small, tiny relays mounted on a printed circuit board, which can switch 12-volt power over what's called binary coded decimal, with three different wires to choose eight different antennas. The software that controls all this has a nice user interface and compatible with Mac and PC and Linux as well. And it's not, again, not connected to that relay box I showed earlier, so that can be out of the way. And this is really powerful, and here's a few examples of this running fully automatically and then a manual mode, and then just a testing screen all the way over on the end for use in a Mac operating system. So the results, this system has worked extremely well in some recent contests. I made close to 1,000 QSOs in a part-time effort during the CQWPX contest with just low wire antennas at home. I did not have a lot of time to operate, but it proved that the station works well. Haven't blown anything up yet. That's pretty good if you ask me. This whole thing is now being put to work in the use in a remote station. And there will be added support in the future for things like single operator two radio. We're developing some code and protocols to handle that. And stacking of arrays for receiving and transmitting, and electrically rotatable antennas, all projects that are being worked on here. This is all fun. I couldn't have done this without help from my amazing Elmers. So many people in this room, it's hard to thank everybody, but just to point out, Carol, thanks so much for having me here. Chip W1YW over there in the crowd. So many of you, it's hard to thank everybody, and I really appreciate it. And I got to learn a lot. I am still here. I can talk to you about it. I'm not in the fetal position under my desk crying in the corner. So I think this whole thing worked out well. Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Okay, again, I hate to rush them through, but 225, the RCA booth, is where you can meet these kids and speak with them. Now I would like to bring up Dhruv Reba, KC9ZJX. And again, in the interest of time, I am going to have to ask you to speak quickly and maybe consolidate a little bit, because you certainly want to hear him and what he's got to say so that you can meet him at the RCA booth. A very interesting young gentleman. Okay, Dhruv, the floor is yours.
Good morning. My name is Dhruv Reba, Kilo Charlie 9 Zulu Juliet X-ray, and I live in Bloomington Normal, Illinois, and I am in sixth grade, and this is my fourth time in a row coming to the Hamvention. Today I'm going to talk about my inspirations and accomplishments in my community service in the United States and India. The beginning. Me and Mr. Ramon are going to the Dayton Hamvention 2013 for the first time. So how did I get inspired towards ham radio? I was mostly inspired by Dr. Kelly Hall, Mr. Ramon, Mr. Satya, and last but not least, my dad. My dad was a ham for 27 years and has been actively involved in providing help in earthquakes and flood relief. These are some pictures of the Dayton Hamvention 2013. I built an AM radio in less than 10 minutes at the ARRL Youth Lounge that year. After the Hamvention, I studied for my technician class exam during my summer break, and I passed it. My call sign is KC9ZJX. That made me the youngest amateur radio operator from the Indian origin in the state of Illinois. LIMCA officially declared that in the LIMCA Book of Records. This gave me an opportunity to inspire the youth to get into the world of ham radio by letting them know the importance of ham radio. The youth includes my school classmates and some school students in India. This is the LIMCA Book of Records webpage from 2015 and 2016. Mr. Keith Hansen, Norm Huber, and Tom Planner helped me set up an antenna in my backyard in the CIRC, the Central Illinois Radio Club, got me involved as a volunteer in various community activities. And they're right there. This is the international dinner at the Dayton Hamvention 2014. And these are a few more pictures. And that's me at the Wright Brothers Museum. And these are some more pictures of the Dayton Hamvention 2014. That's me with AMSAT's new prototype satellite. That year, I met astronaut Colonel Douglas Wheelock, KF5BOC. And I had a TV interview with Ham Radio Now and Tom at W5KUB.com. These are a few pictures of my felicitation at the NIAR, the National Institute of Amateur Radio in India. And I was getting a Beifeng UV5R. I participated in a ham radio awareness program for local engineering college students at the NIAR. And this is a picture with some of the college students and me doing the speech. I passed my general class exam in January 2015. That's me studying for my general, and that's me with some of the examiners. This is my dinner with international hams at the Dayton Hamvention 2015. That same year, I visited the Youth Forum. I'm excited to say that I'm working on the ARIS program in my school, Chittix Junior High School, and we're partnered with the Children's Discovery Museum. And my science teacher, Mrs. Hopper, and our principal, Mr. Allen, and my dad, VU2SPZ, and with the CIRC's help, I'm looking forward to set this up. And this is me with Mrs. Deborah Johnson when she was giving me information about the ARIS program last year. I went on a de-expedition to the Andaman Islands and representing the CIRC, the Central Illinois Radio Club, and I interacted with Indian and German hams. This is a plain view picture of the islands, and these are a few pictures with Indian and German hams. These are a few pictures of me giving my presentation at the de-expedition. While I was there, I visited a school and I explained to the school students during their school assembly the importance of ham radio, and I talked to the principal and the teachers about promoting ham radio. And I went to classrooms 6th through 12th grade and had a question and answer session with them. I also had a television interview while I was there. And we also erected the antenna, and this is me helping erect the antenna. I also volunteered for the We Care Twin Cities Marathon 2 times for McLean County, and we had an incident while I was at net control where a participant fainted during the run, and a nearby ham operator contacted us, and we immediately passed that message to organizers in the emergency unit. This is the CIRC Field Day 2015, and we got 8,542 points and received extra credit points for youth participation. And these are a few pictures of me working a few stations on an IC7100, and in this picture, I stayed there until 10 o'clock making contacts. And that's a picture of us erecting the antenna. I also volunteered for the Hop On for Hope bike ride with Tom, KG9P, and Gary, KD9F. And we had an incident where Kyle, KG9IWs, was at a remote spot and his radio battery was dying. We rescued him by giving him a new handset before he lost contact to net control.
Okay, I am so sorry. I have to cut this off. This needs to be a 4-hour forum, obviously. This talented, wonderful, young, creative ham has so many more things to share. I'm going to have to ask you to meet the people at the booth. He was brought to my attention, you should know, in all fairness, very recently, so we kind of added him on, but I wanted you to get to meet him. Please do stop by 225 and be able to meet with him, and I apologize for interrupting you, okay?
Thank you.
You're up first for next year, okay? He's the first speaker next year. Again, apologies, but we have to do this. There's another forum after us.